Hello, YouTubers, subscribers, cycling enthusiasts, and other legends, guys and girls. Welcome to Veloharmony. This is Eldred here. I had to get out today. It's probably about 50 degrees, which is about 10 Celsius. I mean, compared to what we had over the weekend, where it was like 20 degrees in the morning. Well, it was just really, really brutally cold. You know, I went outside in that thing and I was questioning why I did it. So this is balmy and it feels great. So I wanted to go ahead and change the scenery here. Out in the woods, the birds are chirping. And what I want to talk about today, there's a guy named one of our subscribers or visitor. I'm not sure if he subscribed or not. Refikon Kavakoru. I hope I pronounced that correctly. And then Rockin' Ronnie also made comments about the fact that the last video I did of the Greg LeMond jersey was very entertaining and informative. And so, you know, Revicon said, can you do one about Tom Simpson? I'm wearing the Tom Simpson cap that Rapha did to memorialize Tom Simpson. They did a take on, you know, the British flag. That's where the colors are coming from. And that's the cap. I've got the jersey here as well. Let me show you the jersey. This is the jersey. This jersey, they didn't put a story in the pocket. They've got the Tom Le Plus Fort. That's his, I think it's like a foundation. You know, so they have references to that on here that donate money to charity and so forth. But what I wanted to do is show you where it says Simpsonissimo, Simpsonissimo. The Italians have a habit of, like, regarding Fausto, the late Fausto Coppi, they would say Championissimo, the champion of champions. So they did a spin on that, and Rapha just put there Simpsonissimo, because Simpson was a great champion. And what I want to do is, I found an article. I know the story, but I wanted something that would be concise, because his story is very deep. He was just a special athlete. There's a story in Bike Race Info, I found on Bike Race Info, and I got to give them the credit for that. It summarizes very concisely what I wanted to do, because this is a video, I didn't want to take too much time on it, to give you guys a story about Tom Simpson, his background, which relates to, you know, all the animosity towards Lance Armstrong right now, as if to say he invented doping and so forth and so on. These guys, Tom Simpson, Lance Armstrong, all the other guys, they're not bad people. They're just people that were in situations. Now, I'm not supporting some of the things that Lance did as far as going after his buddies, you know, blocking people's careers and other little things that really, you know, I don't think that was cool. But people need to realize that it was a cultural thing. And people get in situations and, you know, if somebody handed you a pill, one pill, and you smash your competitors, what's to stop you from taking two the next time and three and so forth? And before you know it, you're in the spiral, you know. And to his credit, Tyler Hamilton is now, he's been making these little speeches about, you know, speaking out about what's been going on, because, you know, we lost Pantani, El Pirata, because nobody would say anything about it. They embarrassed him. He got depressed and unfortunately had an overdose with cocaine. So that's just sad. So people need to speak up about it, so that these guys are not ever, the younger kids are not ever put in that situation again. Anyway, I digress. Tom Simpson, this was written by a guy named Owen Mulholland, Bike Race Info. I'll put the link down there, so if you want to read the entire article, you can do yourself, but that's to their credit. It's the most concise article I found that would fit in what I'm trying to do here today.
Tom Simpson was born on November 30, 1937 in Durham in the UK.
So he starts the article by saying, I will read directly, the specter of doping has haunted cycling from bike racing's earliest days. The bomb was always there to save a rider from his weakening self. In Europe, it was an open secret. Even amateur riders toted around enough pills and vials and syringes to establish a small pharmacy. Some of these unidentified products may well have been vitamin supplements, but as for the rest, then he put dot, 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 which coincides with what Tyler Hamilton has been talking about, that he saw these guys with little bags. At that time, he wasn't getting one of those bags, but they were being handed out. in wide open, in broad daylight. So it was noon throughout cycling. The teams were doing this, okay? And that's what this guy is writing about. We're talking about back in the day, 1960-something. This is long, 20-something years before Lance, you know, it came out, you know, 1950. People were doing stuff. So there's another part of the article here where he says, in retrospect, doping has provided the annals of cycling with some of its more amusing moments. There was, for instance, the case of Abdel El Kadar Zaf, a member of the professional North African team. There was a lot of colonization. A lot of countries in North Africa were colonies of some of the countries in Europe. And so in the 1950 Tour de France, on a boiling hot stage from Perpignan to Nîmes, Zaf broke away with a French rider. After establishing a lead, Zaf began to weaken and finally collapsed under a tree, where a local paysan tried to revive him with ample doses of red wine. He was delirious from the heat and the effort and the drugs he had taken and the wine. He didn't come to until he'd been carted off to the hospital. Finally realizing his situation, he demanded to be taken back to the roadside so he could finish the course. But of course, the time limit had already passed. Finish the race. So it had been going on. This is kind of laughable and so forth, but it had been going on so long. That's what he's mentioning in here. But the incident that really made the issue inescapable was the death of Tom Simpson in the 1967 Tour. Only then did the authorities finally wake up to the fact that this was a matter of life and death. It could no longer turn a blind eye. Okay, this is 1967. Of course, just what is dope and what is acceptable scientific preparation has remained a hot debate right up until the present day. The post-Olympic blood doping furor was one of the most recent incidents which show how sticky the issue is. Some of the proponents say that, well, you're making a list, and what if your list is wrong or whatever? Okay, I'll talk about like nitrous oxide, NO2, people pushing all of that. It's not banned or anything, but if you take enough of that, it can affect your body. When you try to get the body to abnormally produce stuff that it normally does naturally, you can do too much. That's the point. Who's going to regulate how much you take? That's what it's all about. So he continues, however, there is an end to the continuum that leads from mineral water to human supercharging, where all can agree certain substances must be banned. Taken in sufficient amounts, amphetamines have the ability to override the body's built-in safeguards. Quite frankly, that is what happened to Tom Simpson on the most tragic day in our history, July 13, 1967.
The pictures you see here was taken a few moments before he collapsed at the end of that tour. Supposedly, the reports are his cheeks were hollow. He had sunken, desperate eyes, ghostly white skin, and he was dry with dehydration. And some of the reports are saying that when you look at the picture, you want to go back in history and drag him off his bike by force if necessary to save him from himself. I mean, the temperature on the road, according to the reports in the afternoon, was 54 C. That's almost 129 degrees Fahrenheit. And it said his body has long stopped sweating, and his heartbeat had climbed well over 200. He'd gone well beyond the red zone that cyclists talk about and slipped into what they call the twilight zone. So his body was no longer under control. Being the competitor that he was, even though he had had gastric problems and other challenges the days before in the tour, he basically was just such a competitor that he continued to push his body. Okay, he was having a rough time. You know, he didn't have much of a team to support him, so he was using more energy earlier in the tour than before they got to Ventoux. And at that point, when they got there, he was tired. I mean, you know, there have been reports where people saw from looking at him that he was tired. So he was below his normal capability. And he was still pushing on. And that's a sad thing, you know, to see this picture here that, you know, they're trying to revive him on the side of the road. So it's the saddest day in cycling history. And hopefully his death was not in vain, that they will take this doping seriously and get it out of the sport.
amphetamines, okay? So, anything taken in moderation is okay, but when you start going beyond, where the body tells you enough, where you start peddling squares, that's a sign you've gone beyond your limit. And you start taking these things, same thing with steroids. Some people take too much steroids, they go in the gym, and before you know it, they're breaking, let's say that the cartilage is going here, or they have all these injuries because they're just doing way beyond what the body can naturally do. They have a lot of injuries, doesn't make the news, but it creates a lot of problems besides the other side effects, psychological side effects. To this day, Simpson remains the greatest road rider England has produced. Arriving in France in 1959, he quickly climbed the rungs of the continental professional ladder.
I decided to show some of the accomplishments of Tom Simpson that most people don't hear about. All we hear about is that, oh, this guy died on Mount Ventoux. This guy won most of the major races out there, or was in contention for quite a bit of the other major races, classics as well as the Tour. So he was an accomplished cyclist.
In 1960, he came close to winning Paris-Roubaix. In 1961, he won the Tour of Flanders. In 1962, he got the maillot jaune, the yellow jersey, for a first time in the Tour de France. In 1965, he was world champion. So this guy was gifted, okay? You know, people talk about, there's a reason they call it performance enhancing drugs. You need to have a performance for it to enhance. If you sit on the couch doing nothing, you can take all the drugs you want. It's not going to do anything. So I don't think it's a good idea. It's not a good example to set for the kids, for people to be taking substances to enhance. But Tyler Hamilton recently said, the Tour de France is too hard. He said that there was a year, I don't know if you guys remember recently when they were racing, they had to do the Alpe d'Huez twice. I mean, Alpe d'Huez is hard enough, but to make them do it twice after a long stage, I mean, because of a spectacle and because of the money, you know, it's a show. So they're going to make more money out of it. That's the problem. You have to think about the riders too. The Tour has always been very challenging. Thousands of miles in 21 days. So why are you adding more difficult things to it? In fact, he even said they need to make it a little easier. Then people wouldn't have a reason to take stuff to finish it. Because these guys are competitors. So, you know, we talk about all these. They're not bad people. You know, Tom Simpson was gifted. He went out there. And the situation, there were other people doing stuff. And he saw that. He's like, man, you know, I'm here for 3 weeks. He wants to win. So, yeah, let me try a little bit and a little bit. Who knows? You know, so if that hadn't been around, he'd probably still be around. He wouldn't have died. He died when he was probably maybe 29 years old, I'm guessing. He was, let's see, when was he born? This was in 1967. Yeah. He was probably almost 30 when he died. You know, that's a young man. So we can't look at these guys as bad people. We need to look at the situation. Marco Pantani's mother said that in a documentary. I sent my son to sport. I expect sport to be good. I didn't expect them to do bad things to him. And she talked about how at times when they came to initially recruit him for the professional ranks, he was very unhappy. He said he wasn't going to ride his bike for like 2 weeks or something like that. He did not ride. She knew something was up. He didn't say anything. But all he said to his mother was cycling was like the mafia. In other words, I implied that they told him he'd have to get on a program. Well, he didn't have to do that as an amateur. They saw his talent, but they told him to come over here. You're going to have to get on a program. So it was institutionalized. So we need to stop, you know, the people who are vilifying Lance. Yeah, he did some crappy stuff, destroying other people's careers or whatever. But he's not the bad guy. The institution needs to clean it up. And doping is not just in cycling. It's throughout sports. And anytime you start pouring big money into stuff, people attempt it. People do stuff. You got young kids, 20s, whatever. The young kids, they look up to these coaches and whatever. They're easily influenced. So We need to just back off and have an open mind. So we need to clean this up so we can have the future Tom Simpsons not die at 29, you know? And some of the other writers who have not made the news, like some friends of Greg LeMond that he talked about, that 25-year-olds having heart attack because they took EPO and the blood was too thick when they went to sleep, that kind of stuff. So I'm coming back to Mr. Simpson because he accomplished a ton of stuff that, you know, and his unfortunate death should not be the only thing we remember about him. That year, 1967, began as in this article, he says it began very auspiciously. Tom Simpson won Paris-Nice. That's not an easy race. It's a week-long race to the sun. Most of the riders now that do Paris-Nice on the way to do the tour as preparation. Okay, one of the young men that Tom Simpson showed clear superiority over was an up-and-coming young rider beginning his third season, and his name was Eddie Merckx. Another one of my heroes. So this guy had talent, okay? He was not a slouch. As always, the tour loomed as the centerpiece of Tom's season. I mean, who wouldn't want to win the Super Bowl of cycling, per se? And he wasn't enthralled when the organizer decided to revert to the old-time formula of national teams. All through the season, riders compete for their trade team sponsors. In Tom's case, it was Peugeot. Now the riders are supposed to forget all about those commitments and race for their respective countries. Back in the day, it was national teams that did the tour, not trade teams. They didn't bring money into the tour. So a small group of homegrown English pros with almost no continental experience were all Tom could look for teammates. So no support. He knew he would be on his own. His game plan, therefore, was to ride cautiously on the flat and save himself for the mountains that year, where the big gaps will make the difference. In the 1967 tour, they followed a clockwise pattern of France. They went across northern France before dropping south through the Vosges and the Alps. Simpson survived those tests very well, although he had to put down the hammer very hard on several occasions. So when you have no team, you got to do all the chasing yourself. So he was already wearing himself out, you know. On July 13 began in Marseille, France. And as he awaited the call to the line, a Belgian journalist noted that Tom looked very tired, and he asked if it was the heat. "No, it's not the heat," Tom replied. "It's the tour." As events were to prove, this was a telling comment. Still, the heat could not be ignored. Already, it was approaching 80 degrees Fahrenheit in the old port city where they started. Many riders winced at the thought of what lay before them. 100 was quite possible, and there was no protection whatsoever on the rocky face of Mount Ventoux, which they were scheduled to tackle around 2 in the afternoon, the hottest part of the day. Okay? The long approach slope to the base of the Giant of Provence, as Mount Ventoux is known locally as the Giant of Provence. It served to shred the field and leave the big guns clustered at the front. Simpson, as expected, was the only member of his team to be in that group because he had an inexperienced team as far as continental racing was concerned. After 7 miles of grueling toil, Simpson began to slip back to a group of chasers about 1 minute behind. In that group was Lucien Aymar, the 66 Tour winner. He remembered how Tom hadn't been content to sit in the group, but kept trying to bridge the gap back up to the front bunch. But no matter how hard he tried, Tom Simpson could not maintain the tempo necessary to move up. Suddenly, Tom dropped from his little cluster of riders, barely able to turn the pedals. He began to weave across the road. In 100 yards, he collapsed. Immediately, he was surrounded by spectators, and to them he appealed in whispered gasps, "Put me back on my bike." These were to be his last words. How unfortunate, huh? The well-meaning fans lifted him onto the saddle and got him going with a good push. When the momentum dwindled, in a few feet, Simpson began his former zigzagging. Another 100 yards and Tom again tottered from the bike. This time, utterly spent, he immediately lapsed into a coma, and nothing the tour doctor or a local hospital where he was taken by helicopter could do brought relief. In 3 hours, Tom Simpson was dead, victim of his own indomitable will and the sorcery of his supposedly magical pills. And I picked this article because it's very concise, because the history of Tom Simpson is deep. And all we hear about is, oh, he's the guy that died on his bike. This guy was a great cyclist from the UK, okay? And came into a situation where he had to take other things because that it was all the culture was all around. Those guys he couldn't get up to, you know, they were on something. And so he was just having a day where his body was depleted, and unfortunately didn't have any support to give him the advice to say, you know what, you need to back off. And he rode beyond what normally your body would prevent you from doing. So I applaud Rapha, because had they not done this, I would not have gone and read up about Tom Simpson. You know, because we don't hear about him that much, because he didn't win the tour and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, he won the world championship. He won the maillot jaune. His class is proven. And this is the jersey that Rapha put together. So when I read the story, I was very moved. And, you know, what Rapha's trying to do, in my opinion, is to shed the light on the fact that you cannot just turn a blind eye to stuff kids are doing. You know, people in their 20s, they're kids. You know, they don't know any better. They're young children, and they come under your care. So when you take a 20-year-old or a 19-year-old and you sign him to your team, you are expected to take care of them. You know, it's not all about winning a bike race. These people have their whole lives ahead of them. They have people that care about them. We're setting examples for the up-and-coming kids. You know, and this is the jersey. This is size large, fits 39 to 42-inch chest, 97 to 107-centimeter chest, and it's modeled, it's styled after the pro team cut. Very tight. You know, so when I wear this jersey, I think about all of that. Fortunately for me, I did cycling. Cycling was not a means for me to live. I got into it. I did some races. I was fairly successful at them, but I didn't need it to pay the bills. You know, I was in the university, and I educated myself and went into corporate America. Cycling was the weekend stuff I would do, travel to races and whatever. We had sponsors, but they were like local bike shops giving us equipment and all of that. So I didn't have a big salary that I was making hundreds of thousands of dollars or whatever, that I had these pressures to do stuff. So I rode my bike and did what came naturally. And you know, so it's kind of like, and a lot of riders did that. You know, you got guys like Le Mans, and when that race clean, they had to retire early because of the doping in the 90s. But what annoys me is that people want to act like Lance started it, just the way that, you know, the kind of coverage. It's almost like a witch hunt. I understand he pissed off a lot of people. You know, I've met Lance. He probably doesn't even remember me. I met him once when I used to live in Austin. He and Steve Bauer, like 1994. This was right after Lance won the world championship. They were out training, and I rode with them for a while. You know, they're nice guys, you know. So he got in a situation where Lance is very competitive. He doesn't know how to quit, you know. And so he took it to a level where I guess most people wouldn't. But we don't need to vilify him for that. And, I don't think Tom Simpson should only be remembered for taking amphetamines and dying on his bike. And so that's why I took the time to do this and read this article to you. This guy won the big races, okay? This guy wore the maillot jaune when he had no support, because that tour that he died in, had they not banned the trade teams from taking part, he would have had a stronger team to support him. He wouldn't have had to use as much energy as he did before they got to Mount Ventoux. But bringing a British team with riders that didn't have continental experience, they could not support him. And that was part of the thing. So he had to do what he had to do, you know. So it's unfortunate, but, you know, the guy's a great, great cyclist. He's a great Englishman that went down there and kicked butt. You know, the Europeans had a problem with people coming from other places, the French, to take over that race. They like to dominate. They were used to dominating that race. And so even when people from Belgium, like when Merckx, you heard about Merckx getting punched in the side and all that kind of crap. You know, the French don't like to lose, and sometimes they go beyond sport to make sure they don't lose. So who knows? Maybe that's why they didn't want the trade teams to participate. Maybe they knew that the British teams were not as experienced. You know, Rapha also did a jersey, which I may cover in the future, about the British invasion later on, when all the Britons started going, when British riders started participating in the continental races and kicking butt later on. They have a jersey in the 80s that they did for they call it the English invasion or something like that. So yeah, so we need to give Tom Simpson kudos, and we need to know that doping is a culture in all these sports, whether they want to talk about it or not. Cycling gets a bad name because they have, I think, the most controls. They've had to put in a lot more tests because they looked away too long. You know, you can't have an open secret and then it leads to young kids dying all the time, dying in their beds. You know, there are stories of riders who in the middle of the night had to set an alarm to get up and get on a trainer so that their blood didn't get too thick while they were sleeping because they were on EPO. I mean, come on. You know, this is a bike race. I mean, let's be real here. So I hope this comes across like I intended, but this is the Tom Simpson jersey. You know, Tom Simpson was a great cyclist, and I hope that more people check into the history of all his accomplishments and not just the fact that this is the rider that died on Mount Ventoux. Maybe it's because of his death that they put all those controls in place, because until then, they were acting like it was a joke. And that's what this guy talks about in this article that I read parts of to you. I will put the link to the article on there for those of you historians that want to dig deeper. But I decided to come outside. Let me know what you think about my new background. This is my backyard with all these trees on here. They create a lot of leaves for me to rake, but it's beautiful back here. And the sun's coming up, so I'm going to wrap up this video so I can get some miles in my legs. You guys, stay calm, stay cool, be safe when you're out there, and check out the details about our sport. This sport is deep and it's very, very beautiful.